I tell you what. Did you guys see our video that we had online for the clock? I thought it was hilarious. I just didn't know if you guys had a chance to see it or not. Driving all the way, my goodness, hello. How many of you, we've kind of been in Isaiah 61. And a couple weeks ago, we shut off the internet because we talked about things that was only for this house. And we didn't want the things we were going to be sharing, some of the things that God was doing, just to stay with us as family for what's going on. And so it really hit home with Isaiah 61. This is where Jesus picked up the scrolls and preached his first message that we're very familiar with, where he's proclaiming the acceptable year of the Lord, where the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. We love this, to point to them that mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes. And if anybody's ever had any ashes in their life, you understand the excitement and the joy that brings. That God can bring beauty out of ashes. The oil of joy for mourning. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. As I'm continuing, I know this is a powerful scripture, but is the heat on? Okay. Well, maybe if the air conditioner could be turned on. But I mean, it's a hot portion of scripture by all means. But what I talked about a couple weeks ago when we shut off the cameras and the internet, it was dealing with this part right here. And they shall build the old wastes. They shall raise up former desolations. They shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. The stranger shall stand and feed your flocks. And it just goes on about how the provision is going to be coming into, and you shall be called priests of the Lord, ministers of our God. And I love verse 7. For your shame you shall have double. I'm going to say that again. For your shame you shall have double. For any time that you've been a part of, and I know we're believers, we're Christians, Spirit-filled believers, and I know we have halos above our head, but somewhere along our journey, we've had some shame that we've had in our life. And if you've ever had any shame, he's giving an amazing, beautiful promise here that his heart is to give us double for anything that we've been, that the devil's put us through. He's wanting to give us double for the confusion. If you've ever been hit so hard in life that it's left you dazed and confused, not understanding upside down from right side up. And he says, you know what? For shame, for confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. For their land, they shall possess double, everlasting joy shall be unto them. That's a lot better than your amen and right there, I'll say. But I want to say this too, that to me, everlasting joy seems to be enough. Everlasting joy. That means joy never ending. Joy from here on out to everlasting. A joy with no end. Now, how do you get better than everlasting joy? How does it get better than that? But he says, double. You shall possess double everlasting joy. I'd be excited just for everlasting joy. But he goes, you know what? That's not even enough. Even though I can't give you a good description of what that is, he does. He says, I have double everlasting joy that shall be your possession. Listen to what God is speaking through his prophet here, and I love this. And so I can't get out of Isaiah 61 with what God's opening doors for us and the building of old wastes and raising up former desolation, repairs the waste cities and desolation of many generations. And if you don't know what I'm talking about in regards to what God's doing in our ministry for our city that we cut off the internet and you slept in that Sunday, but you're here on made up for it on the time change, you're going to have to ask somebody else. But because we're not going to cut off the cameras again this morning. You're going to have to catch up and you'll just have to ask somebody else. So there's different ministries. Now we do look, we want wisdom for our calendars, but some ministries really plan out like the year and sermon series. And if you've been here long enough, you know that's not quite the way it works around here. And every ministry has their own vision in their own heart. So when God speaks something like this, it's not just because we said in the month of February, in the month of March, we're going to deal with repairing the city. That's not. But when God speaks this word and opens up doors and begins to do things, then when God speaks a word, what I do is obviously what we do is we go into the Word of God. I want to study out. I want to find out things that I'm going through. I want to find it in Scripture so I can glean from it and learn. And it's incredible because the Spirit of God will just begin to speak to you and give you encouragement and comfort and promises off what you're doing. So in dealing with building of the way cities, there's probably one of the best examples of that is where I want you to turn now. And I want you to turn to Nehemiah this morning because this is where we're going to continue. Nehemiah, one of the things, it's amazing what he did in his lifetime. Nehemiah, this was during the time era where Israel was invaded. Babylon actually taken them into captivity and weighed their city to waste. And so there are three books in the Bible, even though they're not in chronological order, they are all in the same, they intersect with each other. You have Esther, you have Ezra, and you have Nehemiah. And even Daniel. So in the times of where they intersect, we find that this is an incredible thing. This is the time Nehemiah's in where they had been carried away. You remember Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego taken into pagan cities. Well, we find also here Nehemiah, they're scattered across. Nehemiah's case, he is actually in a position of he's the cupbearer for the king. That's more than just being the food taste tester for the king. It actually meant he had the trust of the king. He had the heart of the king and the ear of the king. Being able to give advice to the king because the king trusted him even with his own life. And so in that, we come to this place where he's coming back and he's expecting to hear some good news because Ezra had already raised up about 50,000 people they want and they had reconstructed the temple in Israel. So at this time and expecting to hear some good news, he gets a different report in Nehemiah chapter 1. And concerning Jerusalem, they said unto me, the remnant that are left, the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. So he was expecting to hear something probably a little bit different, but the walls are collapsed, there's holes in the walls, and the gates are literally on fire, burning with fire. And as it came to pass, when I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned certain days, fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Now, here's one thing I wanted to deal with is the response of Nehemiah. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. God, we ask that your word goes straight into the middle of our heart, into the middle of the situation, the circumstances that we're going through right now in life. And God, I just thank you as you speak to us and you bring change to our life. We thank you for all that you are doing. We ask you to bless your word and open up our ears to hear in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. I want you to bear with me because you're going to find out as we're just getting started here that Nehemiah hears this, the bad news, and his first response, he begins to weep. He has some passion. Now, in his life, he was probably living pretty good being close to the king. He could have been in a different arena when he was a captive taken away to a pagan city, but he's weeping, even though it doesn't affect him personally. He would still be in the courts of the king, even with this bad news, what's going on in Jerusalem. It necessarily didn't affect him personally. But yet, it still begins to pierce his heart, and he begins to weep about this. Now, when you hear some bad news, or you hear that there's holes in the wall, I don't know what your response is. But it really doesn't take long. You don't need to be walking in the office of a prophet to see a gap in a wall. I don't know if you've ever recognized or realized you don't even need to be operating in the gift of spiritual discernment, even though some feel that that's what they have when they're doing this. It doesn't take you long to see some gaps in the wall, but I want to ask you is, what is your response when you see a gap? You see, God's not looking for people that can just point out gaps, because that's kind of easy to do. Matter of fact, some of us are very fine-tuned at it. But that's not what he's looking for. And in Nehemiah's case, when he hears about the gap in the wall, it pierces his heart. He's weeping. He's mourning. Now he goes to prayer and fasting. Now it takes some passion. Anybody in this place that you've ever experienced any fasting, you made that decision to fast, it's going to take some passion to fast in your life. I don't know if you ever have. You can go without breakfast and not even think about it. You're so busy, caught up in your day, to realize, oh, maybe I didn't eat breakfast. The moment you decide I'm going to fast, everything changes. Your stomach never growls, and it's gurgling. I mean, it's like loud. I mean, the radio commercial has a breakfast commercial on it. You're walking out the door, and McDonald's has this great egg sandwich that's calling your name, and you wouldn't have noticed any of it except for, God, I'm going to fast for you today. It's kind of amazing how that works, isn't it? In order for you to get through something with prayer and fasting, you're going to have some passion in your life. And so one of the things we need to do is we need to be able to say, God, I thank you for keeping my heart at a passionate place. Keep me stirred so that when I just hear news that are going on or see gaps in the hole, that I respond in a way that actually it brings a response out of my heart. My heart's not so callous that it doesn't even move me. That God, it's amazing, because we hear bad news every day and it's easy just to let it go in one ear and out the other. But when Nehemiah hears it, his heart is pierced. He begins to weep. Now he begins to pray and he begins to fast. And just for the sake of time, as he goes into his prayer, he's literally going into his prayer, and he's going into it with repentance. God, I repent for the sins of our nation. And isn't that something? That in order, it's not like, God, do you see what's going on to your people? The desolation of the city of God. God, can't you do something? God, what's going on? God, No, that's not his attitude. He's going into it just as Scripture says, that if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves, turn from their wicked ways, that God will hear from heaven. And he's not talking about the people that are on the ends of the bar stools. He's talking to his church. He's saying that if you want to get the attention of heaven, you're going to have to go through some repentance. I didn't think I'd get that big of an amen. I thought maybe a little bit bigger, but it's so important. I know that you've asked Jesus to surrender your heart, and maybe you've even been baptized, but we still need to repent and stay in a lifestyle attitude of living in repentance. And this is one thing I know that captured the heart of heaven, is he's going into it repenting. He's going into this thing repenting. Now, you know, in his lifetime, he's been pulled away into captivity, and it's probably not been the greatest of experiences, and still he's repenting. And we find that he goes into fasting and to praying. And when he begins to tell the king about what's going on in his city, the king literally pays his way to go back to his city to do something about it. Come on, somebody. That means I'm not just pointing out and just going, you know, because it's easy. Here's a way some people could respond. I can't believe there's that hole right there in that wall. Oh, my gosh. How could they let it get like that? All you got to do is put some bricks on there, slap some mortar on there. Now, you know, if it was me, I would just sit here and do it. And that's what a lot of people do when they see the hole in the wall. But that's not the best way to respond. Now, sure, you can complain, and you can even build an audience complaining. Because it's something. How that audience comes to listen about how you would do it if it was you. And if it was up to you, you'd make sure that hole would not be there. But it's easy to stand back when you're doing nothing to complain and tell someone how they should do it. It's easy to stand back and sit in the back seat and be the back seat driver. It's easy to stand back when you're doing nothing and try to criticize and critique those that are doing something. And it's not a matter of being able to point out the holes in the walls. What are you going to do about it? So yeah, you have some passion. Yes, you have some prayer. And intercession is key, and intercession is a must. But he did more than just pray about it. He literally pulled up his robe sleeves and said, let's get to work here. I've prayed about it. I've fasted. I feel like I've heard God on this. And this sounds crazy, but I'm coming to do something about it. And he arrives on the scene upon a city that's in desolation, upon a city where its gates are on fire and there's holes in the wall. And what do you do in this place? Do you put your hands in your face and go, God, how can this ever happen? God, what are we going to do? Now, what we know is up to this time, he was making sure that the king wasn't poisoned. We don't know anything about him constructing and building walls. I don't know if he was a construction worker of his time, but it really doesn't matter. And that's what I love about it. Maybe you weren't trained to do it, but when you see a hole in the wall, the best thing to do is obviously you're asking God, God, what can I do? Or you go to the authority and say, is there anything that I can do? Do you need help in this area? Is there something that I can do to help? What is it that I can do? And then actually do more than pray about it, but you're actually going to step in and step into that gap, and you start getting some bricks and you start getting some stones and you start doing something to repair the hole in the walls. Now, obviously, this is dealing with cities, but not only is this dealing with the cities that we're talking about in our ministry, but we're talking about in your families, rebuilding the walls and the structures in your families. And I don't know if anybody can testify if there's a gap in the family, but there could be a gap or two. And it's up for us as the people of God to begin to not stand back and point out the holes in the wall, to stand back and complain about it, and to do more than just pray about it, but it's time to begin to rebuild the walls of our family, the walls of our city, the walls of our ministry, the walls. This goes beyond just a city. You follow me this morning? Amen. All right. So once he gets upon the scene, we can find that, I don't know what you feel or what you think, but maybe when you're standing at that altar and you got tears coming down your cheek and you're saying, yes, Lord, I surrender my heart, and you feel this passion, you know God's calling you to do it, and you step out in obedience to God. And you're expecting for people to begin congratulating you, patting on the back. Nehemiah's here. All right, Nehemiah, way to go. It's incredible. Thank God you came. But that's not necessarily what happened, and that's all right. So if you ever find yourself at a place of going, God, I thought that maybe the response would be a little bit different than obeying you, it's all right. It's not the first time. And we find in Nehemiah chapter 2, and verse 17 is when he said unto them, you see the distress that we're in, how Jerusalem lieth in waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come, let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that there'll be no more a reproach. And I told him how the hand of my God was good upon me, and the king's words that he had spoken unto me, and he said, let us rise up and build. And they strengthened their hands in this good work. But, I don't know why there always seems to be a but, when Sanballat begins to hear about what's going on, him and his friends get together and they start laughing. And they start scorning and despising. And what do you do? What are you going to rebel against the king? Sanballat begins to mock and ridicule. And so, unfortunately, in that moment of obedience and answering something, an assignment of God, one of the voices that likes to rise up is mocking and ridicule and scorning. And it's not like you're trying to do anything bad. You're trying to do something good. And you hear the scorning voices begin to rise up. But one thing I love about it didn't touch him. And he continued to still do what God had called him to do, regardless of what the other voices were saying. And we can see that once again, a couple verses later, we see it, and there's a couple verses. Let's go to Nehemiah chapter 4, in verse 1. It came to pass when Sanballat heard that we were building the wall, he was wroth, and he took great indignation, and he mocked again. We see in chapter 4, not only is he just upset about it, he's got great indignation. I mean, he's getting passionate about it. And he begins not just laughing with his friends and ridiculing, but now he's mocking the Jews personally. And verse 8, he begins to conspire of all them together to come and fight against Jerusalem and hinder it. Now, this is what happened anyways. The enemies would always just breach the walls and go into the city and attack it at any given whim. This was nothing that was new. And he's starting to create an uprising to go and start to destroy what they were doing. And now Judah begins to say, the strength of the bear is and the burdens is decayed. This is verse 10. There is much rubbish. We're not able to build a wall. What if we're not able to do this? It's not looking too good. It's not like the odds are stacked up against them. And sometimes when you're walking and dealing with obedience with God, you have to look beyond what you can see with your eye. I'm going by what I know. I feel the breath of God upon this. And I know it seems impossible, but we serve a God of the impossible. We serve a God that's able to make up the difference when we don't know where it's going to come from. And we have the adversities that are rising up. And then we have people questioning if they're even able to do it. And this is what Nehemiah does. He begins to place, in verse 13, I set in the lower places behind the wall and on the higher places. And I set people after their families with their swords and their spears and their bows. He begins to take and position people in the gaps of the wall. And they've got their weapons that they are armed and dangerous waiting, both at the high points of the wall and the low points of the wall. And so while these guys are standing ground and standing in their position, the other guys are rebuilding, they're constructing, and they're taking the wall, and they're reinforcing these places while they're standing on guard. And so we see this. And then it came to pass. Now, in the midst of all of this, verse 16, half of my servants wrought in the work. The other half of them held both spears and shields and bows and the rulers were behind the house of Judah. Verse 17, they build upon the wall and they bear burdens and whose laid it, every one with one of his hands wrought in the work and with the other hand he held with a weapon. My gosh. I know. It's just my own personal. It's not too holy, but I love medieval times. Gladiator, Braveheart. Again, I'll repent, but I tell you, I love it. And we find that these people are positioned on the wall. Now listen, in one hand they have a tool for construction, in the other hand they have a sword. Come on, somebody. This is the way to stand in the gap. This is the way to stand in the place. I'm working with one hand and the other, I will kill you if you come up. I mean some business here. I love this. And I tell you what, if we had some of this today, maybe we wouldn't go so fast through those construction zones on the road. But I don't know. That's another sermon. But we find in this place that even in the midst of all this, now what I'm getting ready to say maybe just speaks to pastors, those that are in ministry. But there comes a time when they no longer even have enough money to finish the project. And I know it sounds crazy, but you're trying to do an assignment for God and not having enough money. They literally began to, the families, the poor families were starting to really become upset. They're having to mortgage, they're doing loans and mortgaging, and then even some, they're now had to considering, do my kids get sold into slavery? What are we going to be doing to make sure? And why? Not because they're building their houses. They're fortifying the wall around the city. They're doing something to help for protection of the temple of God. And sometimes what we have to take an understanding is there are many generations that they lived how they wanted to, not caring about the result. And they said, you know what? It could be my children's problem or my grandchildren's problem. But we're just going to do what feels right and feels good. There's too many generations that are really not taking care of the problem. Right. There's so much debt now because our nation, to where there's no way this generation would take an act of God to pay off the national debt. And what's happened is we find too many people that get into this concept to where they're not taking care of the situation. It doesn't bother them because they'll be okay, but it's something their kids are going to have to deal with. And this is what's going on. And they're trying to build something for God in the city of God. And they've ran out of money. Now, this doesn't seem right, guys. Why? Because I've got a passion with tears and I'm fasting. And God said yes. And even my authority, who's not even a Christian boss, this guy's a pagan king, he told me to go and even provided me to go. That sounds like God, doesn't it? You know, unexpected checks, right? That sounds like God all the way. Not only that, but the prophet Jeremiah and Isaiah prophesied about this moment. Some of the greatest prophets of all of history prophesied this word. I'm not just going by minor prophets even. That's a joke. But these are my major prophets that have prophesied this word. So I would think that with passion, prayer, repentance, fasting, and then God's green light to go, and prophets prophesying it, that when I step off onto that yellow brick road, there should be singing and dancing. When I step into that water, I'm waiting for the seas to split, Moses. But I've stepped out in obedience, and not only am I getting all the mockers, not only am my life on the line, I'm having to lay this brick with a sword in my hand. Come on, God, can I get a little help around here? Not only is all this going on, but now we've run out of money. Is this the word of the Lord? Doesn't sound too supernatural, does it? Does this help you and me? I don't know about you, but it helps me. And one thing about this, too, is regardless if he had never laid a stone in a wall in his whole life, he went and he stood in the gap to do it. He heard about it, and he said, I'm going to do more than pray about it. I'm going to do it. And so when it comes to even in the provision aspect, I've already taken the offering, right? There's not going to be a second offering. And as funny as that sounds, there's been some church services I've been in where the pastor took more than one offering. But Lord, forgive me. I'm not judging them. Maybe God told them to do it. I better not preach about it because I don't know what I'm going to need to do next week. So, all right. But when it comes to giving, so often we always stand in this place of trying to fix a problem by, when my ship comes in, man, am I going to bless the church. God, I tell you what, if you let me win this scratch off, I am going to give to you, God. The only reason why we laugh is probably because we've said it before. But you get what I'm trying to say. Like, we feel like when something happens, then I'm going to do it. But the reality is we only start with where we are. Okay? Nehemiah wasn't like he was a stone layer per se. He was making sure the king wasn't drinking poison. And even though he wasn't trained in it, he was going to do something about it. Maybe the wall would have been the leaning tower at some point because he didn't know how to do it, but at least he was going to do something. And maybe I don't have the biggest bank account, but I'm going to start somewhere. I'm not waiting for my ship to come in. As I joked about in the early service, I looked at my wife, our ship still hasn't come in. Maybe you got a report that your ship sank on the sea on the way to get into the dock. I don't know what your case is or what your story is. But I can't wait for something to happen before I'm obedient with what God wants me to do right now. And I love what Lester Summerall said one time. He said, you know what? I've never had enough money for one project God's told me to do. For anything I've done for God, I never started it with enough money. Now see, for a pastor, this makes you feel very good. And for families, it also ought to make you feel good too. So if you're seeing and you're like, God, I feel like I want to do this. There's a lot of people that feel like they are called to be an entrepreneur to bring funds into the kingdom of God. And they're waiting for their business to be successful to do it. But it's got to start with at a place where at times you don't know if you're going to have enough to cover the budget. But you're not going to stop giving even in that moment. You hear what I'm saying? It's not waiting until I'm successful, but I'm going to give even when I'm not on the cover of Forbes magazine, even if I'm not an entrepreneur Daily's magazine, but I'm going to give with what I have now. Now, it may not be thousands, tens of thousands, or millions, but if I got $5, that's where I'm going to start. Two amens. And it's getting hot in here. You thought. We start with where we are. And if Nehemiah would have waited for the provision, the wall never would have been constructed. Do you hear me? And so, I could thank God these children that were so beautifully worshiping this morning, the blessings of families being raised in church. My parents, they raised me in church so often, like we laugh about it, right? You know, how many went to church 9 months before you were born? All right, yeah. Well, I've been to church even before I was born, I was in church. I was in church so much that when I was at a young age, and I used to preach on my grandfather's mantle, and I wasn't just preaching, but I'd even take an offering when I was on that. I was taught from the time all my life on giving was always a part. It was a part of the lifestyle. I've never tried to rise up and debate somebody on what tithe, if tithe is New Testament or if I should give. I've never gotten into stupid arguments. I've always been one. My parents taught me the power of giving at a young age. The blessings of your children, know what it's like from an age growing up like the kids that are here, are so incredible on the blessings of what happens. I can remember as a teenager writing out checks to give, even into ministries. I can remember growing up in my youth group, the church was fundraising to start a TV station in Alton. And I can remember the youth pastor said he wanted to take the antenna to the top of the tower. I can remember writing out a $500 check. And, you know, I didn't have an amazing job. I didn't have, all this. But I can remember all along, I've always not waited. I just started giving along the way. That's a lot of money for a teenager. I can remember when my wife and I, the first time we gave $1,000 at one time. We weren't even married yet. And this minister had really touched and impacted our life. And I can remember... You guys don't want to hear the full story, do you? I told it in the early service. Didn't plan on it. I think it's hilarious. All right. You want to hear a funny giving story? All right. So here it is. It's huge to us. It's $1,000, guys. Like, it's huge to me now. I wasn't even married yet, you know. I'm just letting you know the stretching of faith. So we put it together. We got cash, and we became the stalking people that is just like, we knew where the minister went, and we left the service before it got over, so we were standing in position because we wanted to personally hand it to him. This was huge to us. And all that happened. It played out. He comes alongside, and we say, hey, we just, you know, wanted to give this in our heart, wanted to give this to you, and it was a thank you type of thing, and bless it, and he went on. And, you know, just in my heart, what that was like, just to be able to do that. Man, I'm telling you what, the faith that happens when that is released when you do that. So it was a three-day of services. And on the next night, we go back that next night, and he wasn't even there in the service, and he was supposed to be. And so they began to share that because he walked in a supernatural ministry, a lot of times there would be curses and Satanism but would try to like battle him against even in the services. Well, he was so deathly sick, and they were talking about another attack that was upon him. And I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, oh my gosh. I was wearing a black suit last night. Melissa was in a black dress. Oh, I hope they don't think I'm a Satanist that was trying to curse him. Like, this is a completely different mindset of me thinking, giving that first $1,000 with the clouds parting, angels singing, and like, yeah, you know, that was like the moment of my first, you know, no. Oh my gosh, the minister's sick, and I hope they don't think I was the one that did it. You know, like, that's not what it was supposed to be. I'm just trying to say, all along my life, we've given cars away. We've always been these things of givers, not because we had a surplus. Now, one day that testimony is going to change. But I'm not waiting for that to begin giving. We've got people in different businesses that give in different ways. We've had businesses with landscaping, with the parking lot that have donated and given things that's helped us tremendously. This amazing drum kit that we had a desire. There was no way we could get what we wanted, and somebody has blessed us. There's different ways that people have done it, whether through giving of finances, but this giving thing. What I love about Nehemiah was he didn't wait. He just stepped in and did it. And there's something about when we're in the midst of desolation, of darkness, that who we are and who we're created to be begins to come to life. God said, let us make man in our image, right? And he steps out in the middle of nothing, void and darkness in Genesis 1. And he begins to orchestrate the creation of this beautiful creation. And he did it not because of the resources that he had to work with as far as putting together. He stepped and he created light out of darkness. That's awesome. God is awesome. And when we're at a place where we're going, God, I don't know where the money's going to come from. God, I don't know how to construct this wall and this gap. I don't know how to fix this, God. My family's struggling. I don't know how to fix it. But the moment you step out in faith and you begin to step and begin to do it, the pure creativity that we are made in God's image, who is the one that was a forerunner of creation, and we'd be able to have the ability to create something that we didn't even think we could do. Standing in the gap of desolation, of waste of generations. Gates are on fire and they begin to lay one brick upon a brick, precept upon a precept, line upon line, and we begin to see. And now we come to Nehemiah chapter 6. And listen to this. Right before, I want you to understand this. They haven't completed it, but the wall's getting ready to be completed. Here comes Sanballat. It says, come, let us meet in one of these villages in the plain of Ono. Ono. They thought to do me mischief. And I sent messengers unto them saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and come down to you? I love it. Because not only is there mocking voices, the threat of their life, now comes the distractions. While he's up on the wall, rebuilding the wall, Sanballat's saying, come on down here. Let's have a meeting. Let's talk. Distractions trying to keep you. Once you put your hand to the plow, don't let the distractions stop you. There's no reason for the meeting. No reason. Someone can always tell you, now look, we need to be humble and listen. We can always take wisdom and advice to do things better. But my gosh, it's so aggravating for the people that are doing nothing to constantly try to tell you how to do it. It's like, that's great. I appreciate it. If you want to do it, come help. That would be great. I would love for you to help. Why don't you help be a part of the solution instead of pointing out the problem? Why don't you come? I know it's a desolate situation. I know the gates are on fire. I know it's dark. It looks like it's impossible. I know it's dark, but now that means instead of me throwing my face in my hands that I realize, no, it's dark right now. And so instead of whining about it, it's my time to shine. It's our time as Christians in dark arenas to be the place where we shine even greater. And even though it may have been dark, they stood in the gap with a construction tool in one hand and a sword in the other. Come on, Gateway. I'm talking about standing in the gap, even though all the provision isn't necessarily there, but I'm not going to wait for it to get there. I'm going to start walking in the obedience of God and watch as God does the impossible. And right before the finish, they're still trying to get him come down off the wall. And I don't know why, but it seems like right before that great breakthrough that you've been believing for, that you've been needing happens, there always seems to be that last distraction that wants to get you to come down off the wall. It seems to be that last ditch effort of a fight to try to stop you from your victory, to get you from praising God to complaining about it. And there's always seems to be, and this is right before it's finished, he's calling them down, come on down, get on down off that ladder. Why? Because they say, well, who's they, right? They. You know, people always come telling somebody else is using somebody else's name. Or it's like, please, are you kidding me? Here it is, we see him come down. But he did not stop. And we see, that was verses 2 and 3. You go on down to verse 15, it says, so when the wall was finished, 20 and the fifth day of the month of Elul, and 50 and 2 days. Guys, this had been under destruction for 70 years. I want you to get a picture of what we're talking about. And in 70 years of destruction, Nehemiah and about 150 families reconstructed the wall in 52 days. Less than 2 months. Did they do it because they were overflowing in their pockets? No. Did they do it because there was no fear of losing their life? No. Did they do it because they were ready for it? Maybe not. But they did it anyways. Rebuilding cities, rebuilding families, rebuilding the desolate places. Even with the word of Jeremiah and Isaiah preparing the way, they still got at the place of needing to take out mortgages. They still got at the place of some rough situations. They're back up against the wall of the wall they were trying to rebuild. And we can find, I love here verse 15, so the wall was finished in that 52 days, and it came to pass, listen to this, all of our enemies heard thereof, and all the heathen that there that was about to saw these things, and they were much cast down in their own eyes, for they perceived that this work was wrought of our God. He started this journey in praying and fasting, and he ends it in praise. He starts this journey, and it doesn't seem like there's a lot of supernatural stuff going on. You know, like Elijah got an angel to cook for him. Pretty amazing. It'd have been sweet to have some angels help lay some bricks, God. No, I got a construction tool in one hand and a sword in the other. But the enemies are downcast at what's going on, and they begin to give praises that this was the work of God, and it is. And sometimes the most supernatural works of God are done with a construction tool in one hand and a sword in the other. What we can find is they can reconstruct this wall to have protection of their city, to have protection around the temple to worship God without the threat of the attacks of the enemy coming in and out as they please. We find them giving their praise. All this is in a moment of a Esther that was so seemingly hidden that nobody knew, not even Haman, being raised up with this revelation. I was born for such a time as this. What a revelation to come to in our life, to realize I could have been born at any time in history, but God has me here now. Why? There is a city somewhere that I'm going to be standing in the gap. I need to put some bricks in. There's a family somewhere that needs the life of God poured into. And as excited as we are about checks in the mail, how incredible it is when we're the ones writing the checks and sending them in the mail. Come on, Gateway. Can I hear an amen? Amen. We're talking about standing up and being a solution. So Nehemiah prays for God to do something and repents. Then he rolls up his sleeves and he becomes a part of the solution, a part of the answer to the prayer. We have outreaches that are incredible. Whether it's this week was juvenile diversion, where these families are going through dark places in their life. Never did they think that their kid's not old enough to drive, but they're standing before a judge in a courtroom because they've made some stupid decisions. And in that dark place of that family, we find there's a light that comes shining through and saying, hey, we've got an answer here. Let us help you mentor them, help them, and pour into their lives. Shining a light into dark places, rebuilding desolations of generations. What we talked about 2 weeks ago when we cut off the internet, that too. What we're talking about in our families, when we say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And after you've made that decision, and after you've declared it, and after you've surrendered your heart to God, you got to roll up your sleeves. You got to love even when those kids don't seem too lovely. You got to love even if it hurts. You got to sit there and you got to get some blood, sweat, and tears going on to rebuild some holes in the walls of your families. Why? In desolate times, we find a place for us to shine even greater. So we've got some cards that the ushers will help that we have made up in the back there on the table. They're going to start passing out. They look like stones on purpose because we're rebuilding the desolate places, the waste cities. There's there's three lines of names of people. I don't know if you realized it, but in just about 4 weeks is Resurrection Sunday. Now, we always do resurrection seed. We always are having a seed that we plant on Resurrection Sunday. But let me tell you what, Resurrection Sunday is an incredible time. Maybe you've got somebody you've been trying to minister to, somebody that you've been trying to lead to the Lord or bring back to God, family member, a friend, or maybe even an enemy. Well, we have three lines on there. We want you to pray about the three people that you just feel like in the next 4 weeks that you just got in your heart that you want to see their life turned around. Maybe it's more than three people, but we just made three lines on there. I want you to pray about three people. God, who are three people that I can reach out to and impact in the next 4 weeks? I'm telling you what, even people that say they come to this church and only come once a year, they're going to be here on Resurrection Sunday. That's the time. Like, everybody goes to church on Easter, Resurrection Sunday. So this is that time. We actually have cards that we make up that you can invite people to. We make it easy. You can send invites on Facebook, emails. Like, we try to make it available and give you tools to help reach those people you've been pouring into. And I want you just to begin to pray right now. I want you to fill out those three people on the card. Now, on the back of that card, I want you to turn it around. And as everybody stands, it might be hard to write and stand at the same time, but I want you to pray and ask God, what are the gaps that you feel like He's calling you to help be a part of the solution for? There, it's the back. It's a blank sheet of paper on the back for a reason. You can fill in what it is that God has. Where is it in the city? Is there an outreach that God's placed on your heart in our city? Is there something going on that you're just like, you know, God, I feel like I want to do this. I don't know what the ministry, what the church is doing about it, but write it down. We want to help be a part of you helping to rebuild whatever assignment God's placed on your heart. We want to see that. We want to pray over it. After you fill out these cards, we've got some that are turned in here. We're going to start praying over these cards. We're going to start praying over these cards personally with the prayer teams, the intercessor prayers, and then the ministry team, but the staff, we're just going to be praying over these cards, and then we want to come alongside. And see, I got a card right here from the last service, and I see these names that are on here. We're just going to believe every wayward daughter, every wayward son, that God just begin to deal with their heart. Their hearts be arrested by the love of God. And here on the back, I've got places for family. They got different things to lift up family. We're going to pray about it, but we're also going to come alongside whatever we can do to help and be a part. We want to see the assignments being released and accomplished in this day. So I want you to pray, begin filling those out right now. And like with everything, when God gives us a word, we get into the word and we say, God, this is how Nehemiah did it. Lord, if you called us to rebuild places in our city and these families are in our life, God, I want it like that. And so God, give me a heart of prayer, God. Give me a passion and a dedication to begin to fast about this gap that I see, that I begin to fast over it. And then after that, he went into repenting. And through the repenting, then he pulled up his sleeves and he began to see whatever he could do to do something about it. And if you respond in these ways like Nehemiah, it positions you to be at the right place to accomplish the reason why you were born. To accomplish, not just to pray about something, but to become an answer to the prayer that you see. It's an opportunity for you and I to realize, like in Esther, to say, for such a time as this, am I born. Like in Ezra, that rebuilds the waste cities. Like in Nehemiah, that rebuilds the desolation of generations. We're talking about for your families. We're talking about for families, cities, ministries. So I want you to have that in your hand as we pray. Lord, we thank you as we take a stone, as this card represents a stone in the wall. Lord, we take this stone as a place of positioning it into the rebuilding of fallen places of the city, of the cities of our heart, of the cities of our family, of the cities of our ministry. And God, we start off with the repentance, oh Lord, that you would forgive. We repent of anything that would have allowed it, opened up the doorway of the enemy to come in and wreak havoc on our life. God, we repent from turning away from you, walking away from you. We repent for not being faithful, oh God. We repent for our sin in Jesus' name. And Lord, we forgive. We forgive those that have wronged, hurt, wounded. Lord, we choose forgiveness. Lord, we choose to walk in forgiveness. And Lord, we thank you for the reconstruction of our families. In our cities. In Jesus' mighty name. Jesus' mighty name. Maybe the ushers could collect them in a bucket or something, and we're just going to bring them up here to the altar after that's done. I'm looking at some incredible men and women of God, construction tools in one hand, sword in the other. God's called us for such a time as this, Gateway. God's called us for such a time as this. rebuilding in Granite City, rebuilding here in Edwardsville, Glen Carbon, being a part of a solution to issues and problems in our city, rebuilding families, reconstruction, putting together families that have come through tragedy, families that have made some wrong decisions, some wrong choices, and we're standing up upon the top of the wall and the low places of the wall and standing in the gap. God, I thank you for raising us up to accomplish the assignment that you have upon our lives. God, we thank you for the double of shame, for the double, oh God, of confusion, of the possession of our land. We thank you, God. I thank you for beauty for ashes. I thank you for the oil of joy for mourning. I thank you, oh God. I thank you that your spirit is upon us because you have anointed us to preach the good news, to preach the gospel, to set those who are captives, to set them free, to declare and proclaim the year of our God, the year of the Lord. God, I thank you for your anointing upon us, the anointing for construction, the anointing for loving, the anointing for loving the unlovely. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. If you're here this morning, you have any special prayer requests, then we're opening up this altar here this morning. Whether you want to surrender your heart to Jesus for the first time, or you want to do it again, a fresh rededication. If you need healing in your body, or you just want prayer for something going on in your life or in your family, step out as we worship with this song, and we'll meet you right up here as the ministry team and pastors will be right up here watching heaven move on your behalf.
God of strength.